Hello, everyone. I am a nuclear medicine physician, as Dr. Tanuj said. My name is Dr. Swagat, and I am here to discuss about PET-CT neuro-oncology. Many of you must be wondering when to refer and what to expect. Let's see if I can clarify that. Hybrid PET-CT has enabled a combination of morphologic and functional imaging. Most common radiotracer used for the PET imaging is FDG. PSMA labeled gallium-68 and F-18 for the imaging of carcinoma prostate. Further advance has been made in the past decade with the development of newer radiotracers and optimization of the technical aspects. Urological oncology is an active field in imaging research, and many modalities have been evaluated. Metabolic imaging with PET has been evaluated for its ability to outperform conventional imaging modalities in urological cancer. With the advent of hybrid PET-CT and PET-MRI, morphologic and functional imaging has been combined with the promise of providing better information in guiding therapy. Now coming to renal cancer, this is the most common solid tumor of the kidneys, accounting to 3% of all malignancies. Most common histologic subtype is clear cell RCC, followed by papillary carcinoma. Standard imaging evaluation is done with ultrasound, CT, and MRI. Cross-sectional imaging, especially a CT scan, is the primary imaging modality of choice. Surgical resection through either partial or radical nephrectomy remains the mainstay of treatment. FDG PET-CT plays an important role in the preoperative workup. In one study, it has sensitivity of 62% and specificity of 88% of the renal lesions and 79% and 90% respectively for the extrarenal lesions. So as you can see, specificity is very high for the renal and extrarenal lesion both. And based on the SUV values, PET-CT could differentiate high-grade from low-grade tumor with the cutoff SUV max of 3.0, sensitivity 89% and specificity 87%. Fairly good, isn't it? Higher FDG uptake correlates with higher Forman grade, higher TNM stage, and presence of vascular and lymphatic invasion. Sometimes possible to differentiate malignant renal tumors from benign etiologies, high-grade clear cell RCCs and papillary RCCs have significantly higher SUVs. Cutoff SUV max of 2.2 has sensitivity 65% and specificity 89% in differentiating benign and malignant tumors. PET-CT can detect metastasis in subcentimetric nodes, which are not considered significant on CCT because it relies on size criteria. PET-CT also can differentiate tumor thrombus from bland thrombus using cutoff SUV max. It has well-established role in detecting and quantifying metastatic burden in RCC, thereby significant impact on management. Single doubtful metastatic lesion on CT can be evaluated with PET-CT. There is significant difference in SUV max of RCC with and without metastasis. It is better than technetium MDP bone scan in evaluating skeletal mets because, as you know, renal cancer, they give light to osteolytic bone metastasis. MDP bone scan is a marker of osteoblastic activity. So a pure osteolytic lesion with no osteoblastic activity, it can be falsely negative on a MDP bone scan. That's why FDG PET-CT is better indicated. Ability of FDG PET to assess tumor grade and metastatic burden has enabled prediction of prognosis and survival. Recently, other radiotracers, they are also being used like gallium-68 PSMA. PET-CT has an important role in the active surveillance. There is a study by Alonghi et al. Where they evaluated 104 patients with proven recurrence after surgery. And they showed that 74% of sensitivity and 80% of specificity for FDG PET-CT, with PET findings having influenced the management in 43% of patients. Positive PET was associated with worse survival rates. False negative cases are mainly due to small size of the lesion and limited spatial resolution of the scanner. False positive results occur due to concomitant infection, postoperative scar, or post-radiation inflammation. Park and his colleagues noted that postoperative positivity on FDG PET in recurrence was not influenced by the nuclear grade of the tumor. And another study by Nakatani and his team observed that sensitivity rose to 100% for recurrent papillary RCC as against other subtypes. Advanced unresectable RCCs are resistant to conventional chemotherapy and they need treatment with tyrosine kinase inhibitors. For the estimate of response assessment, CT is not a very good modality because it depends upon the size criteria. However, even if a lesion which is showing response, it may show an early increase in size. So PET-CT might have role in early prediction of response. Other PET radiotracers evaluated in response assessment in RCC are F-meso, FLT, fluoroethylcholine, C11 acetate, and gallium PSMA. I'm showing you one image. This is a case of left renal RCC. You can clearly see one exophytic left renal Bosnia grade 4 mass, which is closely abutting the underlying collecting system. It's N score 3 in renal nephrometry score. And in the same scale, we did CT urographic images along with PET, and you can see synchronous lesions along the same side, distal ureter and VUJ. So these are all synchronous lesions. This is one case, sarcomatoid RCC with renal vein IVC tumor thrombosis. The same case, left renal vein thrombosis going into infrahepatic IVC, clearly FDG avid. Then coming to malignant adrenal tumors, mostly they are benign. Two main tumors are adrenocortical carcinoma and pheochromocytoma. FDG PET has better accuracy than CCT in diagnosing malignancy in the case of adrenocortical carcinoma, lymphomas, neuroblastomas, and similar accuracy in case of malignant pheochromocytoma. However, till date, PET-CT is not useful in differentiating the different malignant subtypes. In the workup of SEC, PET-CT is able to detect more distant metastasis than CCT. It is also helpful in identifying metastases which are occult on CT, accurately targeting biopsies in tumors with hemorrhage, necrosis, as well as in collision tumors. In malignant pheochromocytoma, PET-CT is better than MIBG scan because MIBG show uptake only in well-differentiated tumor. FDG PET-CT also has a better at detecting metastasis. Other PET radiotracers, FDOPA, gallium dotatate, they are touted to have better sensitivity and positive predictive value than FDG. However, more evidence are awaited. Primary tumor of the pelvic system, they are quite rare. 91% are of TCC. Mostly they are synchronous or metachronous. Evaluation of primary tumors by pelvic system by FDG is difficult because the normal urinary activity, especially in small tumors. Despite this, Asai and their team, they observed a sensitivity of 83% of urinary tract urothelial carcinoma and no correlation between uptake and tumor stage or grade. FDG PET-CT is superior to CCT in the detection of distant metastasis and influences the management in a significant number of patients. It has better overall survival and progression-free survival for patients who showed response on FDG PET-CT. It is more accurate than CCT for detecting local and distant recurrence post-surgery. This is a borrowed slide in which you can see left distal ureteric FDG avid mass with nodal and skeletal metastasis. Then carcinoma urinary bladder, the urothelial carcinoma is the most common bladder cancer histology. Tumors are divided into non-muscle invasive bladder cancer comprising of stages T1, TA and carcinoma in situ, muscle invasive bladder cancer, T2A and beyond. Tumor grade is an important prognostic factor. Cystoscopy is the gold standard in screening. MRI is more sensitive for T staging. Nayak et al. From AIIMS, Delhi, they evaluated FDG PET-CT post-forced diuresis with LASIX, which improved the lesion detection with better sensitivity detection of the primary tumor and pelvic nodes than CCT. However, PET-CT has no role in the prediction of muscle invasion. In a meta-analysis, sensitivity is 82% and specificity 89% for the PET-CT in detecting metastasis in primary and recurrent bladder tumor. It alters management in approximately 20% of the patients with muscle invasive tumor. PET avid extravesical lesion is associated with overall poor survival in patients with muscle invasive cancer. It can help in assessing response to neoadjuvant therapy. PET responders have better overall survival and progression-free survival. It has a value in restaging bladder cancer post-radical cystectomy in detecting both local recurrence and distant metastasis. Now, what NCCN guidelines says about FDG PET-CT in carcinoma urinary bladder, there are selected indication in muscle invasive bladder cancers, that is in staging in selected patient beyond clinical T2 and beyond. Follow-up with or without cystectomy whenever metastasis is suspected. Follow-up of clinical T4B and metastatic disease if it is not done previously PET-CT or high-risk patient in whom metastasis is suspected. It can also guide biopsy in certain patients. and evaluation of suspected bone metastasis. This is a case where a patient is having recurrent carcinoma urinary bladder, where you can see FDG avid intravesical mucosal thickening along anterolateral aspect with extensive nodal and peritoneal hepatic metastasis. Now coming to testicular tumors, most are of germ cell origin. Germ cell are histologically two types, seminomas, non-seminomas. When CCT is used for staging and response assessment, detection of micrometastasis in subsymmetric lymph nodes is not possible. CCT has limited value in the differentiation of fibrosis and residual tumor. One study by Ambrosini and his colleague, FDG PET-CT shows sensitivity for the detection of seminoma at 92% and specificity at 84%. And another study by Treglia and team sensitivity approximately 78% for the post-chemotherapy residual lesion and specificity 86%. PET-CT has a high negative predictive value according to this study, and authors recommend only follow-up PET-CT negative PET-negative lesion when even if they are larger than the CT cutoff size of 3 cm. Then in response evaluation and follow-up, false positive results are quite high, so it is advised to keep a gap of 6 weeks between end of chemotherapy and FDG PET-CT scan. Mature teratomas do not show FDG uptake, so not recommended to do PET-CT. PET-CT has a validated role in the follow-up of seminomatous germ cell tumor. What NCCN guidelines says in subsequent treatment strategies, stage 2-3 after orchidectomy and primary treatment with chemotherapy, if CT shows residual mass more than 3 cm or and normal tumor marker, then PET-CT scan is recommended after 6 weeks. If PET scan is negative, only follow up PET scan if clinically indicated. Stage 2B, 2C, 3 after orchidectomy and primary treatment, if CT shows no residual mass or residual mass less than 3 cm and normal tumor markers, then follow up PET scan as and when indicated clinically. Non-seminomatous lesion, PET-CT is not clinically indicated. This is a case of seminoma right testis with metastatic right inguinal, pelvic, and abdominal lymphadenopathy. And this is another case, interesting one. Patient was under evaluation for suspicious left testicular mass. On FDG PET-CT, we could see left testicular mass, large one, necrotic, left inguinal lymphadenopathy, mediastinal and hilar lymphadenopathy, bilateral lung nodules, and thrombosis of IVC. Clearly visible in the middle image. Biopsy from left inguinal lymph node revealed lymphoma, that is diffuse large B cell lymphoma, NHL. Now coming to penile carcinoma, all cancers are FDG avid. However, PET-CT is not recommended for primary staging. One meta-analysis showed pooled sensitivity of 57% only for clinically palpable. For pelvic lymph, if the palpable lymph node is enlarged and are present. Now, this is a table which in which it summarizes the role of FDG, PET-CT, and other tracers in all these cancers. I have highlighted only the role of FDG and their potential application. As you can see, renal cancer, FDG has a potential application in metastatic workup, restaging, treatment response, bladder cancer, metastatic workup and restaging, testicular, nodal and distant metastatic workup, follow-up of seminomatous lesion, in penile cancer, nodal and distant metastatic workup in patient with palpable inguinal lymph node. However, out of these, NCCN recommends only in testicular cancer, and the recommendation is follow-up of seminomatous tumor after chemotherapy when the residual tumor larger than 3 cm. Now coming to carcinoma of prostate, it is the second most common cancer in men worldwide. Then risk stratified according to serum PSA level, Gleason score, and clinical stage. Multiparametric MR imaging is the procedure of choice, and it is best for T staging. PET-CT has low overall sensitivity and specificity because most prostate cancer, they characterized by use of non-glucose metabolic pathways such as fatty acid metabolism or fructose metabolism. Considerable overlap exists at the level of FDG accumulation between normal prostate gland, BHP, prostatitis, and prostate cancer. However, higher sensitivity of the FDG PET in the detection of primary disease has been reported in patients with higher PSA level and advanced cancer. when the Gleason score more than equal to 7 in men with an intermediate or greater risk of prostate cancer on the basis of their PSA level. FDG uptake increases with the increasing Gleason score, clinical stage, and serum PSA level, suggesting that FDG PET-CT might be useful in selected cases. In general, it has limited role. It may give prognostic information regarding cancer-free survival. It has higher sensitivity for detecting metastatic lesion than primary. Potential role of FDG in early detection of CRPC and response assessment of osseous metastasis. This is the case where I have shown that FDG avid prostate carcinoma. It is a poorly differentiated variety of carcinoma prostate, which is FDG avid. It is seen in infiltrating bladder, rectum, and left seminal vesicle. Then other tracers are C11 choline, F18 choline that target cell membrane metabolism. NCCN guideline recommends the use in biochemical relapse, particularly in patients with PSA level more than or equal to 1 nanogram per ml after radical prostatectomy and after multiparametric MR has been done in radical radiation therapy in candidates suitable for salvage therapy. Then coming to PSMA, it is a type 2 transmembrane glycoprotein. Expression is 100 to 1000 times more in carcinoma prostate. Expression increases with the increasing tumor stage and grade and in castration resistant prostate cancer. The radiotracers available to be labeled with PSMA are gallium 68 and F18. Sensitivity, specificity, and prospective predictive value for gallium 68 and F18 PSMA, they are all comparable. However, local extension of the disease may be better delineated with F18 PSMA radioligand, as it is excreted through hepatobiliary route as opposed to renal route for gallium 68 radioligand. Now, here I am showing on your left side what you can see is a F18 PSMA scan, no bladder uptake, and high tumor to background contrast. And in another case, on your right side, what you can see is a gallium 68 PSMA scan, here bladder uptake decreasing the tumor to background contrast. For this reason, I personally prefer F18 PSMA more than gallium PSMA. Recent guidelines indicate the use of PSMA PET-CT in the staging of high-risk patient before surgery or EBRT in cases in which detection of radiologically occult nodal or bone metastasis would substantially affect the patient management. ENM and SNMMI, they have suggested that PSMA PET-CT is useful to help identify the site of recurrence and guide salvage therapy. A recent update in EAU guidelines recommends imaging with PSMA PET-CT if the PSA level is 1 nanogram ml or more after radical prostatectomy. Gallium or F18 PSMA is highly sensitive for biochemical relapse with low serum PSA level. And the lutetium 177 and yttrium-90 labeled PSMA radioligands offer the potential for targeted radionuclide therapy. Here, this is a case of gallium 68 PSMA PET-CT, 75-year male, on and off hematuria, diagnosed adenocarcinoma prostate, Gleason score 4+5, serum PSA 85.9, and bone scan shows multiple osteoblastic metastases. The scan shows densely PSMA avid prostatic lesion, mainly involving right peripheral zone, then pelvic, retroperitoneal, and left supraclavicular lymph nodes, all PSMA avid, along with PSMA avid skeletal lesions. Then other tracers in carcinoma prostate in use are F18 labeled fluciclovine. It is an amino acid analog superior to choline in the setting of biochemical relapse and has recently been approved by FDA for detection of recurrent carcinoma prostate. Another is sodium fluoride, F18 labeled. It's an analog of hydroxyl group in hydroxyapatite bone crystal. FDA approved in for PET-CT indicated in the evaluation of metastatic bone disease and also in the evaluation of treatment response. It has superior diagnostic performance, sodium fluoride F18 bone scan. However, it has relative lack of specificity compared with the specificity of other PET tracers and does not allow the assessment of soft tissue. This is an F18 bone scan of a patient with a known carcinoma prostate showing metastatic pelvic lesions and left clavicular lesion. Then the PET tracer clinical use with their possible role. I have highlighted FDG and PSMA only. FDG for possible role in response assessment of osseous disease in metastatic CRPC prognostic indicator and gallium PSMA or F18 PSMA for that reason in biochemical relapse at low PSA level. And my talk won't be complete if I don't talk about PET MRI. As you know, MRI is a better modality for prostate cancer because of high soft tissue contrast. So the recent hybrid functional imaging advancement is PSMA PET MRI. These are the borrowed images. I don't do PET MRI. These are borrowed from Apollo Hospital, Mumbai, Delhi. And this is a case of local recurrence, clearly and very well visualized on MRI images. This is a done with gallium 68. Now the take home points: functional imaging of PET tracers targeting various aspects of the natural tumor biology of prostate cancer has demonstrated superior detection compared with conventional imaging with CT, MR imaging, or bone scintigraphy. A particular strength of PET imaging is the early detection of disease in patient with biochemical relapse, a strength that provides the opportunity for a personalized approach or precision medicine with localized salvage therapy or a treatment of oligometastatic disease with intention of possible cure or improved outcome. With improvisation of CT protocol that includes CT renal angiography and CT urography in addition to routine CT whole body, with diuretic intervention and delayed dual point PET imaging, PET CT can negate many traditional shortcomings and may position itself as the one-stop approach in clinical uro-oncology practice. Now, with this, I rest my case, and I hope I have succeeded in answering many questions.